Hey, how's it going? Dylan here. Just a quick introduction to this new discussion video that myself and the media man Connor have put together for this month. We're going to start doing these once a month, and we're going to choose alternatively the next movie. So at the end of this one, Connor chooses what we're going to watch next and discuss next month. So sit back, grab a coffee. Hope you enjoy our discussion on Alien 3, which is one of my favourite Alien installments. Also, this is now going to be available on iTunes under the podcast name of Now Watching. So go have a search for that if you want to just listen audio-wise on the way to work, whatever, anything you want. Enjoy. All right, so I watched Alien 3, the assembly cut, as a rewatch, like two nights ago, and some of it last night as well. I hadn't really watched it for probably a year, I reckon. You rewatched it last night. How long has it been since you last watched it?
I haven't watched it for quite a long time. I only watched the assembly cut once before this, because I grew up watching the theatrical, because I only ever had the DVD. So yeah. Probably a good couple of years since I've watched this assembly cut, I'd say.
Ah, cool. Yeah. So what are your initial thoughts on your rewatch?
I really like Alien 3. That was like immediate when I started watching it. I love the style of it and the soundtrack, the setting. I always did like Alien 3. It gets a bad rap.
Definitely, but, yeah.
On a rewatch, I found I actually appreciated it a little bit more than I did when I was younger, especially because when I was younger, I was in the Aliens as the better one over Alien camp.
Yep.
Whereas now that my opinions changed and I like Alien more, I've warmed up to Alien 3 a lot more as well.
Yeah, I'm in a similar camp. It's I really like the way, like, and you mentioned the soundtrack. The soundtrack's really good. I really enjoy, like, especially the opening. I like the way how it intercuts between the space credits scene and what's happening on the Sulaku.
Sulaku.
Yeah. I like how it intercuts with that and the music during that. It has a real good sense of, like, kind of setting up what, like, setting up the initial premise without having to do much.
Yeah. I really like the Alien films, especially like the first three, all feel really distinct. And Alien 3 almost feels like the most distinct because it feels like a gothic horror in a lot of ways, which I really like about it. It just like jumps off the screen as soon as you start watching it in a really cool way.
Yeah, it's really interesting, like, visually, obviously, visually as well, it has a distinct look from the other two, like, the first one being very, like, kind of, well, the first two kind of almost have a blue hue to everything, whereas this is, like, complete opposite, and has, like, a yellow, sickly yellow-green tone to almost the whole picture, and it, like, gives a real good kind of contrast. Has some, actually, I was surprised because I, even though I'd watched it like a year ago, cinematography wise, it's really good. I noticed that this is technically probably the only time David Fincher's actually shot anamorphic.
Yeah.
Because all of his other films are, like, he frames for anamorphic, but he never uses anamorphic lenses.
Yeah. It's really interesting as viewing it as Fincher's first movie as well, seeing how even then a lot of his trademarks were still around. You can tell what he's going to end up making just by watching Alien 3.
Correct, yeah.
I know he distances himself from it as much as he can, but I still think he made a hell of a good movie here. So.
Oh, definitely. And I think that, yeah, it was mainly the studio side, because it's clear in the commentary on the assembly cut as well that, like, because they basically, the commentary track on it is like a bunch of some of the cast, the production designers, effects designers, and things like that. And from, listening to that, like, it comes across that they all really like David Fincher. And they multiple of them, like, multiple ones of them, like, praise him over the studio and the commentary as well. Like, saying about his vision and, like, that he probably should have fought harder. But,
So I was going to ask, I think everyone, well, everyone is aware that when Alien 3 came out, it didn't do well, especially with fans at the time.
Yeah.
So I was going to ask, in your opinion, what do you think would have caused that? Because I noticed a lot of people tend to have differing opinions on why people responded to it this way.
I don't know. I think that, like, obviously, I have... when I originally watched all of the Aliens, I was maybe like 13 or 14. And I had rented all of them at once, like all four. So I watched them in succession. And, like, for me personally, I didn't really have a problem with it. But I guess that what happens is, like, when there's time between them and people build up things that they really enjoy about one of them, waiting for the next, it's really the anticipation, I guess, that kind of disappoints them. Because they're thinking it should be like the previous one or etc. And I think a lot of people got turned off by the deaths at the start, I guess.
But that's a big thing. That's a big theory for me as to why people responded to it this way.
Yeah. Like, I mean, I understand, like, from what I know, like, that Fincher wanted to do that to kind of make it his own thing, to kind of clean the slate, so that he can do, like, what he wanted to, which I think works well. I like this as a self, like, it's kind of almost as if self-contained. It's not a continuation per se. Yeah.
Well, I actually like it a lot that they do away with a lot of the Alien supporting cast at the start, because it feels like such a bold move after the end of Aliens.
Yeah, and it obviously, because he wanted a different tone, different type of film, whereas Aliens is very action-oriented. So it's a nice kind of, like, to kind of go back to not exactly the same as the first, but to have some of the more slower burn stuff going on.
I think it's definitely a film that is unfortunately looked down upon, which seems to be turning around now. I've noticed a lot of people watching on Alien 3.
And it's almost as if at the moment, even, like, you either love it or absolutely despise it.
Pretty much.
I've never seen anyone say, "Oh, it's all right." It's either like, that's a horrible movie, like, that doesn't exist or whatever, or like, for instance, with the rumored Ultra HD releases coming out next year or something, like, a ton of people are like, "Oh, we're just gonna buy the first two." And I was like, no way, I'll definitely buy all of them, really. This one, like, has a, like, this is probably my second favorite Alien film behind Alien.
I'd say mine go in order, Alien to Aliens, then Alien 3, and then Alien Resurrection, which I still like, but has a lot of problems.
I'm the same. I think that's fun, a fun thing, but it's interesting.
It always amazes me that I see a lot of people that they'll completely deride Alien 3, they'll bash it, but then they'll say they don't mind Resurrection.
Yeah, that is a bit odd. I really love... one of the things I really love about Alien 3 is the supporting cast. Like, Charles Dance is fantastic in it. Like, all of the, like, prisoners, like, do a really good job. And it really kind of helps with it, like, their banter and all that. Like, in the Assembly Cut, for instance, when they're bringing in the Ox, like, just that conversation is just really well done. And, like, I don't think that a lot of people really look at the kind of the dialogue in it. Because it plays really well, and the actors play really well off each other.
I think this is probably my favorite Charles S. Dutton performance. I love Dylan's character so much.
Yes, it is fantastic, and it's, like, very iconic. like his lines, and the way he kind of portrays them is like always stuck in my mind, like his speech when they're throwing the bodies in the void.
Yeah, it's a that's such a great scene.
Mm.
What strikes me about Alien 3, specifically the assembly cut, is unlike nearly any movie I can think of apart from maybe Kingdom of Heaven, it's such a different experience watching the assembly cut that it can almost feel like a different movie.
Oh, certainly. And I didn't, like, for instance, back when I actually didn't know about there was two cuts, like years ago, and I had, like when I bought the Blu-ray, I had only seen the standard cut. And when I went to, I didn't know that originally I'd seen the assembly cut.
Yeah.
And I thought that was just the standard film. And then when I bought the Blu-ray or rented it or something like that, I went to watch it. And the first thing I noticed when I saw the dog, that the fact that the alien comes out of a dog.
Yeah.
And I was like, I'm sure it wasn't a dog. I'm sitting there going like, this is really strange. And there was a bunch of stuff missing that I could swear was in it and that I remembered. And it wasn't till like a year later that I realized when I got the actual proper Blu-ray and watched the the 2000 like special edition version, which is as they call it on the Blu-ray, that it was a different cut and I'd actually missed out the year before.
Yeah, I remember talking to someone about Alien 3 and they mentioned the ox alien and I had no idea what they were talking about. It was always the dog alien when I was watching it.
Mm, yeah.
Because I showed it, because I watched it with my partner last night and she's never seen it before. We watched the assembly cut and afterwards I was talking about how different it was and she asked for like an example and I said, well, almost all of the ideas of religion aren't in the original cut.
Yeah.
Mm. And she's taken aback by that because that's such a big part of the story. I said, yeah, that's how different the cut is.
Yeah. Which is, it's an interesting case of Fox going back and like saying, oh, we were probably wrong. Like kind of thing. When they went and did the assembly cut because it's based on his work print that he presented them. But yeah, that's an interesting little kind of backtrack on their part because it's obviously it's universally pretty much considered the better movie.
Yeah. Have you heard about the original cut that Fincher showed in the UK?
I haven't heard a lot about it, no.
From what I've heard, it was about 3 hours long or over 3 hours long.
Right.
And the thing that struck me when I heard about it is it was apparently considerably more violent.
Yep.
Which surprised me because Alien 3 is already the most violent of the series.
Well, especially the assembly cut.
Yeah.
Like that intro shot of Hicks.
Yeah.
It was like his jaw is just like off.
Apparently it was so violent that they showed it to a test audience in the UK and that was all they talked about. So the studio breathed down Fincher's neck and he had to turn it down.
Mm. Yeah.
Which would be, this is probably one of the best examples of studios getting involved with movies.
Yeah, well, definitely. Like so much so that he doesn't consider it even close to his vision. Although he hasn't watched the assembly cut. I believe.
Oh, but, really?
Yeah, I believe he said in an interview that he hadn't actually watched it, so he has no comment on it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Which is a shame, obviously. And also, it's interesting the guy who, like, what's his name? Cronenworth, the cinematographer of Blade Runner, was shooting this for 2 days or 4 days or whatever. And then he got too sick because he had Parkinson's, and that's why he had to be replaced.
Okay.
Huh.
I know when I would show people Alien 3, one of the things I'd love to show them immediately, either before or afterwards, would be the original trailer.
Yep.
You've seen the original trailer?
Yes, I have, yeah.
I love to show... Actually, I like to show people that before I show them the movie, so then I can tell them that it's not actually set on Earth, and I see their reactions.
Yes, yeah.
When I see all that stuff, I do sort of understand the reaction to the film, even though I do love Alien 3.
Mm.
I can imagine going in expecting it to be set on Earth and being a little disappointed by that.
Well, yeah, and not only that, like, it had been in production for so long, it had a year of editing. So it was a year of post-production, and they did reshoots without Fincher, to do multiple other things, and like it kind of, it's probably one of the biggest examples of that. There's a few others, but this is probably the most talked about, I guess. In terms of like one that actually made the movie basically flop. It's the only one I know of that they actually backtracked on afterwards.
Yeah. One thing that I do notice about it though is because I've looked it up a couple of times. I've watched plenty of videos online about it because I'm such a big fan of the franchise.
Yep.
And every time I look at how much interference there was and how many things went wrong, how many writers they went through, and then I look at the film and think, it's still great. Even the theatrical cut, to go through all that and still be this film is really impressive to me.
Yeah. The one thing I hate about Alien 3, the one thing I don't like, is the rear projection alien effects. Which are terrible. They look... Yeah. Really bad, which is basically you've seen how they did it, right? It's literally a rear projection, and they had a puppet, and then they project the scene behind it and kind of re-record it. And it was just, it just looks bad in every shot that that's in. When you compare that to the puppet they used when it's walking out the ox, that looks great. It just looks so bad in the lighting, and the lighting doesn't match at all. It's just bad.
I remember when I first found out that that wasn't CGI when I was younger, I was blown away by that idea. It does suck that the first moment that it really jumps out as looking bad is just before like the most iconic moment in the movie. That one shot where it's walking over to Ripley always just stands out so badly.
Yeah, especially compared to the next shot when it's a close-up practical and that looks so good.
I actually think the time that it looks worst is there's one bit where I think it's towards the end, it's attacking one of the prisoners and it's like got him on the roof.
Yeah.
And you can just tell that they're not in the same room. But it is a shame because the practical stuff in this film looks so good.
Oh, definitely. It was obviously on the right on the edge of the kind of more digital stuff coming in. So like the practical stuff was kind of like at top of their game at the time. It's just that with the rear projection was probably a bad idea to be honest.
I do really like the designs in this movie though. That makes up for it. I think that the prison looks great. All of the sets look great.
Yeah, they're lit really well. They kind of have a real, lived-in, gritty production design.
Yeah.
Basically a factory.
I'm a big sucker for matte paintings, and I really like matte paintings. Yep.
Yeah, there's quite a few. Which you miss out in the theatrical cut.
So many differences. One thing that I did notice on this rewatch actually was how much humor there is in this one.
Yes,
really stood out to me. I found I was laughing a couple of times when I wasn't expecting to. I think the big standout, I think one of the best scenes in the whole franchise is when it just after the alien kills the lead guard, the warden of the prison, and then the most like well-timed swear in the whole movie.
Yes, yeah, yeah, the the one, like, it was this had to be rated R in the US, I'm guessing.
I'd say so. There's a lot of violence and swearing.
I'm guessing that it would have gone for an R. I do like that scene as well. And I think, correct me if I'm wrong, in the assembly cut, the scene is longer. Ripley running through the corridors.
Yeah, they drag it out a lot more.
In the theatrical cut, she like runs down one corridor and then she's there. Kind of thing. But in this one, I noticed that there was a difference in terms of like they kind of played through the whole speech while she was running.
Yeah, well, because Dylan's he does another speech about religion there.
Yeah.
That's not in the theatrical cut at all.
Right.
I do love immediately after that scene when there's the one guard mopping under the vent.
Yeah,
he's trying to not. I always wonder why he's even bothering, but I get such a kick out of that scene.
Yeah, that is a good scene. I laughed quite a bit with that one. I also always laugh at Bishop at the end, how his ear's hanging off and he's like, fine.
Oh, I'd never noticed that before until this rewatch. So gross.
Yeah, I'm like, really, if that happened to someone, like, they would be walking around. Most likely, because like it's literally just hanging off.
I do think it's pretty interesting how much you end up enjoying, how much you end up liking the prisoners by the end of the movie.
Yeah,
because they're very upfront that they're terrible people. Dylan said straight away, "I'm a murderer. I'm a rapist." But by the end of it, you do end up caring for them a bit, rooting for them, except for the one prisoner who I, when they were running around at the end, I was like, has he been in the movie before? I think he's like the last one to die when they're doing the trick in the hall.
It feels like that he was cut from other he was probably in scenes maybe in that 3-hour cut, he just kind of got cut out and then he just appears. That's one of the main type like symptoms of when you see like interference like that, when the studios recut a film and retroactively change story, like things don't exactly kind of make sense sometimes, completely gel together.
I really enjoyed that scene. I think I've always loved that scene where they're trying to trap it in the halls. I think it's, I like the pacing of it a lot.
It works pretty well. It's pretty good like to watch. And all the sound design and things like that.
Yeah. I forgot how many big names are actually in this one as well. Like Charles Dance.
Yeah.
I didn't know at the time because I've since watched Game of Thrones and everything.
Yep.
Peter Postlewaite is also in it.
Yeah. I saw quite a few people, like with smaller parts and like just around the place. It had a pretty good cast, and I'm a pretty big fan of most of it, really. It's a fun film. It's probably the one that I have the most fun rewatching. Because like the rest of them, like even Alien, I probably wouldn't have as much fun rewatching it as 3. Because it's just like one of those movies where you can kind of keep watching it, and it doesn't get old at all. Like there's something to kind of keep you interested, even if you've watched it recently.
One thing that I don't mind, I like that there's no weapons. I think that's a really great setup. We've established in previous films how dangerous this thing is, and now we've got nothing to fight it with.
Yeah.
Which might be the my favorite example of ridiculous actor demand actually benefiting the film in a tiny bit. Because one of my favorite things looking into Alien 3 is Sigourney Weaver's ridiculous demands when she did this movie. Some of it really surprises me.
Yeah, she's very passionate about the character, and she owns it basically. So like, you know, and she can really do that. She built the character, basically, and she kind of can call the shots, because what are you going to do if she walks away? Kind of thing.
But that's... I just think this film has a good setup in general. The trapped on this planet, there's no weapons, Ripley can't really trust anyone.
Yeah.
It's just a really good setting. I like Fury a lot. I like the lice being everywhere as well. It's really, like, gross.
I also like the fact that Charles Dance's character dies, like, halfway through. Instead of, like, because you get the impression, in terms of a standard kind of cliche film, he would be maybe stick around to the end.
Yeah.
Because he's, like, her closest ally, I guess. So, yeah, and the fact that he just, he's gone. One of the first times you properly see the alien in the film. And I like the fact that literally the one person she kind of trusts is gone. Like they kind of build that up and then it's gone.
Yeah, it really suddenly and not gracefully as well.
Yeah,
I think that's part of the reason why I like that they off Hicks and Newt at the start, is it reinforces this idea that Ripley has nothing now.
Yeah.
I love that scene after she realizes she's got the chest burster, and when she goes up to the xenomorph, she's saying, like, I don't remember, we've been doing this so long, I don't remember life without you.
Yep. Yeah.
Because nothing good sticks around for her. The only thing good on this planet got killed by it straight away.
Definitely. Yeah. And I do love that scene where, like, she sees it and she tries to hit it and it's a pipe.
Yeah. I always want to rewatch that scene because the pipe looks nothing like the alien.
Yeah, I know.
On the second time.
You're sitting there like, really? I guess trick of the mind kind of thing. Yeah. In high stress.
Mm.
I can understand. Like that happening. But it kind of makes me wish. Because, like, obviously it is such a Fincher film when you think about it. Like the way, like that, with those people dying early on, like it's dark. Like the themes wise, it's kind of obviously it doesn't end happy, it definitely kind of sets up his rest of his career, basically. Although he didn't work on anything for a while after it, which is understandable. It's just a shame that Fox decided to do all that.
Yeah, it's going well though, which is good. I'm really glad to see people coming around Alien 3.
Yeah, I always forget the year, like how early it was made in the 90s. In my mind, I always think of it as mid 90s for some reason. But it's actually really early 90s. It was a year in editing. It came out in 92, so it'd be filmed in 91. So it's pretty kind of super early on, and it looks great for its age. Visually, like, well, the print at least, I guess, was well preserved. But it was definitely not kind of, like, considering it was shot on anamorphic, which back then they were less light absorbent as well. People had issues like having a dark movie shooting on anamorphic, but the director of photography in the commentary just says, meh. He's like, I don't care. He's like, I never had a problem. Everyone else is kind of wusses or whatever. It has a distinct visual style. And I think it definitely will be the only ever time you'll see an anamorphic Fincher film, because he hates anamorphic. He's all about reframing and post and things like that. So,
One thing I do, there's a subtle thing I like in the movie that I didn't notice until others pointed it out, with the lice.
Mm-hmm.
Because when they bring in the ox, it's absolutely infested with lice.
Yep.
Which is also one bit where they bring in this infested ox that died suddenly, and they talk about it being young, and it just suddenly keeled over, and the person was like, We'll put it in a stew.
Yep.
Okay. What else are you going to eat, I guess? But when Charles Dance's character finds Ripley, she's also completely covered in them. And there's the idea that it's because they both have the alien inside of them.
Oh, yeah.
The lice are attracted because there's more of a life form there.
Oh, yeah. I never thought about that. Yeah.
Yeah. I really like that idea.
Well, technically, they're crickets. But
oh, yeah. That's true.
It's like the most ridiculous. I mean, it works.
Yeah.
But it's just ridiculous when you think about it. Wait. Like, they are way bigger than lice.
Yeah. I guess you've got to. You got to have a visual there so that people understand.
Makes sense. And I never really picked it up on it before. Like, when I watch the commentary and you hear them talking about, oh, my God, we found crickets and everything, like, months after and all this. Like, inside the ox prosthetic and all that. they, like, shipped it back to, like, LA, like, a year later or something. There were still live crickets in there.
Yeah. I think also Alien 3 introduced one of the most interesting ideas about the creature that they don't really do a whole lot with after this. It's that it will change depending on the host that it chooses. Yeah.
And I like that kind of idea.
Yeah. Well, as a kid, that like sent my imagination haywire.
Well, I guess they kind of adhered to it in Resurrection because they have the like the OG ones basically when they're hatched out of humans. And like the original kind of look and color and everything. So I guess they kind of adhered to it, but they didn't kind of expand on it.
Love to see that. Well, the only thing I can think of that does that again is AVP2, which isn't the best movie. No.
Well, and technically I guess Covenant to a degree like kind of implies that like, you know, it depends on the life form it infects. That kind of it's like kind of a chain evolution that it infects first and then like the next generation kind of are different again. Depending on what they have infected. But, yeah, it doesn't really make it super clear.
Yeah. I actually really like... I feel like if they had have stopped at Alien 3, and I'm glad they didn't because I really love Prometheus and Alien Covenant.
Yeah, yeah.
But it would have been a really good end to a trilogy.
Oh, definitely. It makes sense. Like, it's obvious they kind of hinted at that, obviously, like from the way it ends. But obviously, the studio wants more money, and then we got to 97, we got Resurrection.
Yeah, I do like Resurrection, but
Resurrection's another interesting kind of matching of director to theme.
I've never seen Amelie. I need to watch it.
I haven't either. Yeah.
No, I've heard really great things, but there's so many just odd choices in Resurrection, like Ripley being the clone, which kind of that works. The newborn alien doesn't work for me.
No, no. And
such an odd time.
There's inconsistencies, like for instance, like if they had a piece of her DNA, the alien DNA wouldn't be in it.
Yeah.
Like the alien was itself in her. It wasn't merging with her, so if they got like a hair of hers, then they're not going to get the alien DNA, so it doesn't kind of invalidates the entire setup to the story. I never understood that side of things. I like the cast and some of the things in it, and I like the underwater scene.
That is a good scene,
but most of it doesn't, like, kind of interesting.
But actually bringing up because Alien 3 does have one sort of hurdle that you have to deal with right at the start, which is the facehugger being on board the ship. Because if you do think about it, it sort of doesn't make sense in regards to the end of Aliens, because the Queen doesn't go inside their ship, the one that they end up sleeping in, and it's also like awfully convenient that she would just put two eggs in there.
Yeah.
But I can completely forgive that. It's the... Well, you wouldn't have a movie without an alien. Yeah. So deal with it.
Yeah, of all the ones, like, you know, that's just a basic one, I guess. Yeah. It's not convoluted or anything. It's just like, oh, there's an egg there.
Yeah.
Like, you know, it's... of course it was, kind of thing. Like, the audience would forgive that, generally. Yeah. Like, a basic thing. It's like, no, we're just going to put it there, because how else would you continue it?
Yeah, okay. It works at face value.
Yeah.
It's only when you really think about it, which... I'm happy with stuff like that.
Yeah, well. Yeah, it's fine. And like the intro makes up for it anyway, because it's really well edited.
Yeah, I really like how creepy the intro is. The one shot of the face hugger.
Yep.
Oh, it's weirded me out.
Yep. Yeah. Yeah. Just coming around the corner.
That's actually, I really love in the assembly cut in the ox scene, the end of that scene.
Yes.
The guard picks up the face hugger.
He's like, what's this?
What's this? Yeah. It cuts really quickly. I think it's a really great, like...
Yeah. And it doesn't show a close-up or anything. It's, like, from really far away. It's a wide shot. And you just see the silhouette of it, kind of thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because if I remember correctly, in the theatrical, you see the face hugger go onto the dog and all that. Whereas I really like when they're talking about the ox and, you know, I just keeled over, it was in its prime, and you're putting it together in your mind.
Yeah.
It
works much better.
I really love the first quarter or so of this movie is almost like, it feels like a mystery movie in a way, or like an investigative movie where Ripley's slowly trying to figure out if one of them has survived.
Definitely, yeah.
It has probably the most depressing scene in the movie where she has to do the autopsy on it.
Yes, and that was one of the scenes that was more gory in the... I knew about that scene being a lot more gory, like, because they built a full prosthetic with multiple layers to be cut open and everything, yeah.
Which, I'm actually glad they didn't have
It works pretty well without seeing most of it, just with the sounds and the amount of blood.
And they have that one shot where he opens the ribs, so you see it for a second. I think that works so much more. It's more effective than if you had this big gore prop. I think it would sort of desensitize you to it by the end.
Yeah, of course. It works a lot better in the, like, knowing what they're doing, leaving it to the imagination.
But yeah, it definitely holds up. That's for certain. Apart from the... that one effect.
That's why I'm really holding out. I really hope Fox, the Ultra HD releases the assembly cut, which it should be, because that's the one that's really been, like, that was the special edition one. So you'd hope so. Because if they don't do that, I can imagine a lot of people are upset. Or if they just do both, I guess. But
I'd say they might do both. They have a tendency to do that ever since they started re-releasing the Alien movies, they always stuck in the special editions as well. Which this is my... I think out of all of them, this is the best special edition. It's the one that actually
drastically
improves the movie.
Yeah, I think like Alien, the original one, is like a few scenes different. Like it's literally like a few minutes difference. Ridley goes on, he's like, oh, just changed a few things. Or whatever. So it's nowhere near as the drastic changes.
Yeah, it more reminds me of like the Lord of the Rings extended cuts, where it's more just, here's a little bit more of this world if you're a big fan of it. Especially Aliens, you get that extra scene at the start where it's, this is here, we fixed the movie. But yeah, that... I definitely enjoy it. It's a really good movie.
Yeah, it definitely is. Thanks for listening. We're going to be doing this once a month, I think we decided.
Yeah, once a month sounds
good. Yeah, once a month. And we're going to be choosing taking alternate turns choosing what the next movie will be. And we'll be inviting some people on, like last time, for example, with Mike, to talk about certain movies if they want to join in.
Yeah, if you're listening to this and you want to join in, let us know. We're more than happy to have anyone on.
Yeah, most definitely.
If you're passionate about movies.
Yep, talk about movies, any movie, whatever.
Yeah. We're filming suggestions. For maybe not Gods of Egypt again.
Maybe not, but I am getting an Ultra HD review copy, so.
Oh, yeah. Maybe we'll have
to. Yes, so that'll be fun. But yeah, I hope you enjoyed listening. Be sure to, I don't know what you do on iTunes. Do you subscribe or you do you
follow? I've got no idea. Do what you do on iTunes.
Yeah, click download and like. Leave a rating, that's it.
Yeah, there we go.
Leave a rating, a comment on air, because at the moment it just says no data found.
Yeah.
But yeah, hope you enjoyed. And yeah,
all right.
I'll record a separate thing for the YouTube one. But yeah, should be good. Now we're going to choose. It's Connor's turn to choose next time's movie.
All right. So I was thinking, since Hold the Dark is coming out next week, it would be a good time to watch Blue Ruin.
Oh, okay, yeah. That sounds good. I haven't seen it.
Ah, awesome. Yeah. It should be good then. That's my pick.
Awesome. No problem. All right. Well, I think we'll wrap it up there.
No worries.
Thank you very much for listening / watching our discussion on Alien 3, Assembly Cut specifically today. It's pretty long, I know, but thanks for watching on YouTube. Don't forget to hit the like button below if you enjoyed it. Hit subscribe if you want to see more. Hit that bell button to be notified of new uploads as they become available. And hit me up on Twitter or the comments. Let me know anything at all. Coffee, film, whatever. Also, go check out Connor's channel, The Media Man. Search him and find him. Links below. Till next time, take care.